Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents From the Front Row, Reflections of a Major League Baseball Owner and Modern Art Dealer by Jeffrey H. Loria. Narrated by John McLain. Great baseball players have much in common with great artists. Both put their talents on the line, and neither is easily stifled by criticism. And both possess an innate ability to focus on their objectives and block out all distractions. Indeed, exceptional talents in all fields share these common threads. This book is the story of my twin passions for art and baseball, two worlds that are not nearly as different and separate as they may seem. To me, a baseball stadium has much in common with an artist's studio. Both are places filled with drama, suspense, and magic, and I have always felt wholly at ease in either a studio or a clubhouse. For more than five decades, I have been uniquely privileged to witness truly exceptional talent from the front row. The excitement of watching and working with creative people has kept me on the edge of my seat, eager for more. What happens on a baseball field also happens in art, as well as in our lives. What we see turns into what we feel. I am deeply fortunate to have come of age in an era when art and artists were still very much a face-to-face and indeed heart-to-heart enterprise. Authenticity and admiration were not yet pitted against anonymous bidders shrouded behind phone banks at auction houses. I still marvel at how I was able, as a young man in my early 20s, to knock on the artist Edward Hopper's door in New York's Washington Square and have him graciously usher me into his unfurnished living room where he kept his printing press. Art was personal. In much the same way, I later had the good fortune to join professional sports, ultimately being at the helm of Major League Baseball's Miami Marlins during the twilight of the era of instinct, before athletes were so heavily defined by analytics and when managers could still trust their guts rather than having to work around algorithms. Of course, there have been challenges. The art world is a largely private place that prizes discretion. Art dealers support, encourage, collaborate with, and champion artists, while at the same time, they quietly help collectors and institutions find the perfect work, the object of deep meaning or visual delight. Being with artists inside their private working environments and studios provides an intimate, in-depth look at the creative process, which is powerful to behold. The world of professional sports is, however, the complete opposite. The public spotlight is constant and strong. Owning the Florida, later Miami Marlins, meant experiencing the gamut of emotions, from exhilarating, including a 2003 World Series championship, to challenging. But it was never dull. I learned to live with sensational headlines, and the highs of thrilling celebrations, and the lows of withering criticism. Often, the person I read about in the press and the person who I am bore no resemblance to each other. But for many who work in professional sports, that is, as the saying goes, the price of admission. I've been very lucky, beyond my wildest imagination, to have achieved success in two very different worlds. Like most people, my own life has been filled with peaks and valleys. I have known deep tragedy and adversity, as well as good fortune, with serendipity, timing, and chance playing their own parts. And I realize now that I was also making memories, which, of course, are the currency of life. I have written this book with the intention of not only sharing stories from my experiences, but of making those stories something that the listener can feel. In the process of navigating the arenas of the arts and professional baseball, as well as philanthropy, commerce, and education, I have also learned a thing or two along the way, which I hope to convey. If there is one overarching lesson I would like to share, it is that passion is the key. We may value art, or value athletic talent, in monetary terms, but we cannot put a price tag on passion. There is no substitute for it in work and in life. When you are passionate about your work, regardless of whether it involves multiple interests or even seemingly contrasting ones, a drive for excellence becomes the common denominator. If I had pursued only my interests in art, well, I would have done okay and had a great life with extraordinary experiences. Knowing and working with many of the world's most famous artists has indeed yielded a life of curiosity and satisfaction. But like most people, I have had more than one interest. Yet I didn't stop to worry if these different interests would clash. Instead, I realized that the knowledge I had gained from the art world, including how to navigate myriad rules and guidelines, could help me to achieve even greater success in baseball than I had ever thought possible. Here, I hope that some of my experiences might inspire listeners and share with them the varied ways of reasoning and seeing that can help anyone to realize their own victories in their own realms. Some of the earliest lessons I learned growing up in New York City and later as a student at Yale were to always keep an open mind and continuously look and listen. We are all actors on a stage, but we are also the audience to the greatness that finds its way into our lives. If we take a seat in the front row, we have the opportunity not only to witness the best in life, but also to learn how to call the plays that will ultimately move and shape our world. JHL, New York, 2022. Chapter 1. Dreams Do Come True. The greatest danger for most of us lies not in setting our aim too high and falling short, but in setting our aim too low and achieving our mark. Michelangelo. I have experienced other epic moments in stadiums and ballparks across the country, but this day is different. It's a clear, crisp, late Saturday afternoon in October 2003. My mind is racing and my heart is thumping with excitement. I am sitting in the visitor's dugout at Yankee Stadium, waiting for the first game of the World Series to begin. Imagine, the little Florida Marlins ball club with a payroll of $54 million going up against the mighty New York Yankees with their $164 million payroll and storied history, including such legends as Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, Joe DiMaggio, and Mickey Mantle. I had chased this dream virtually all my life, first laboring extremely hard to work my way into baseball by purchasing a minor league franchise, and then eventually owning a major league team. This was a unique championship series. It was the 100th anniversary of the World Series, and widely advertised as such. The Yankees were appearing in their 6th World Series in the last 8 years. Having amassed 25 championships, 39 pennants, and a veritable brand name status, the Yankees were in a league of their own. For the Marlins, this was our second trip in 6 years to the postseason, but our franchise was only 10 years old. We were also the first team to be led by a 73-year-old manager, the incomparable Trader Jack McKeon, who ultimately became the oldest manager to win the World Series in the history of our national pastime. For some of our players, this was also their first trip to the hallowed Yankee Stadium, and it was evident from the outset that our opponents were masters of intimidation without even trying. The pinstripes alone conjured up apprehension. From the moment we arrived at the stadium and ascended the stairs to the visitors' clubhouse, large signs reminded us of who was in charge. Joe DiMaggio's sign, declaring, "I want to thank the good Lord for making me a Yankee," stared us in the face before we even took our first steps to the clubhouse level below. That sign, however, made me smile. I had grown up an excited Yankee fan and was now walking those venerable halls with my own Florida team. I still get goosebumps just thinking about it. It looked, however, like our players did not share my eager emotional state. Sitting in the dugout observing batting practice with Jack and then watching our players return from center field's Monument Park, where they had glimpsed the bronze faces, plaques, and sheer number of Yankee legends, I realized that the Marlin players seemed intimidated and not their usual confident selves. To further make the point, the public address system was blasting Frank Sinatra's iconic song, New York, New York, while the Jumbotron highlighted the Yankees' prior glory in black and white film. It was supremely brilliant, and not at all subliminal marketing. As the players descended into the dugout and headed to the visitors' clubhouse to prepare mentally for their first inning, I could see anxiety written all over their faces. Although I too was anxious with anticipation, I felt we had come so far, and after so much hard work, that fear and failure were not options. I told Jack that I sensed a problem and asked if I could speak with his players. He replied, "Of course, they are not my players, they are your fucking players. Half of them don't even know if they are in New York or Hoboken." Jack encouraged me to take a few minutes to address the team, but I only needed 60 seconds. I got their attention by slamming a bat on the table in the middle of the clubhouse. As the players gathered around, I tried to convey to them that we belonged here in the World Series. We had earned it. We had been the hottest team in baseball since the All-Star break. I told them that we also deserved to be here because we were smarter, faster, younger, and better. I reminded them that all those greats in Monument Park had been their age at some point, but they were now retired or dead and could not play tonight. This was our time. We were going to beat the Yankees. And we did. During the New York week of the series, I stayed at my home in Manhattan, and I remember feeling the tremendous energy. Before the first game, on my way to the stadium, I stopped at a bodega on Madison Avenue and bought the New York Post and the New York Times to see what they were predicting. The headline in the Post read, "Fish Fry." Needless to say, we were the underdogs and not exactly beloved. When our team bus traveled up Madison Avenue, we were booed the entire way. As the series' first game began, emotions were elevated. When our experienced and talented leadoff hitter, Juan Pierre, safely bunted a fastball in the first inning, I had a strong premonition that more success was going to follow. But being superstitious, like many in baseball, I kept my feelings to myself for fear of jinxing our efforts. The Marlins won that first game 3-2. Our closer, Yugueth Urbina, pitched the ninth inning in his usual heroic fashion. We had handed the Yankees their first home loss during a World Series since 1996. Back in Yankee Stadium for Game 6, even though the Marlins were leading the series 3-2, the Bronx Bombers were still heavily favored. But as fate would have it, the series didn't make it to 7 games. In Game 6, Jack McKeon's tactics were nothing short of brilliant. He decided to start our 23-year-old ace, Josh Beckett, with only 3 days of rest, an unheard-of choice in baseball. Usually, starting pitchers require 4 to 5 days between starts. To get Beckett's mind off baseball for a few hours that afternoon, I had taken him to Barney's New York, the former high-end department store on Madison Avenue in Manhattan, to buy some shirts. I told him his wardrobe needed an upgrade. But Beckett had his own way of releasing the pressure before a World Series start, with a unique pregame ritual that I hadn't seen before. When I arrived at the stadium, I found him sprawled comfortably on a clubhouse couch, immersed in watching cartoons, and oblivious to his surroundings. I realized then that nothing was going to distract him from winning. As the game began, I sat overwhelmed with emotion next to my security person, John Anderson, who had loyally helped me for years. During one tension-filled moment, John turned and saw the consternation on my face. "Why so serious?" he asked. I explained the weight of this game for me and how a lifetime of memories had come flooding back, a disproportionate number of them involving my late father. The flashback of my dad taking me to my first baseball game in the old Yankee Stadium made me wonder what he would have thought if he could have seen what I was witnessing from my now front row seat. I'll never forget John's reaction. Without hesitation, he elbowed me hard in the stomach and said, "You're about to win the World Series. Why the hell are you thinking about that right now?" At the bottom of the ninth, the Marlins were ahead 2-0. A stone-faced Beckett took to the mound and retired the last three batters for the victory. We won the World Series on that Saturday night, October 25th, at Yankee Stadium. When we got the third and final out, I could only repeat to myself, "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God." I was told later that the hometown celebration practically stopped traffic on Interstate 95 in Miami. By contrast, on the subway ride back into Manhattan from the Bronx, I was told that it was so quiet, you actually could hear the proverbial pin drop. Beckett's pitching made Jack's risky and unconventional choice of starting him with a mere 3 days' rest seem to be an act of genius, and it was. The complete shutout of the Yankees in the final game made him the first pitcher to accomplish that feat since Jack Morris of the Minnesota Twins did so in 1991. The Marlins also scored the game's only runs on three consecutive two-out singles by Alex Gonzalez, Juan Pierre, and Luis Castillo in the fifth, and Juan Encarnacion's sacrifice fly in the sixth. It's still amazing to recall the opposing lineup. We had beaten future Hall of Fame players Mariano Rivera, Roger Clemens, and Derek Jeter. It was an extremely gratifying experience, but also mind-blowing. We weren't supposed to do this. But isn't that what life is all about? Good things sometimes happen when least expected, and I had learned early on in my life to expect the unexpected. Jack McKeon is without question an exceptional manager and a very special man. He deserves an abundance of credit for his leadership and for the faith he had in his players. This triumph was a capstone to a truly remarkable career. The Marlins' victory that October was a prime example of expecting the unexpected. During the celebratory melee on the infield immediately following our victory, everything was a blur. The occasion was obviously highly emotional, not only for our jubilant team, but also for the New York fans, who were in a state of utter shock and uncharacteristically silent. They were, however, very classy in defeat. As our players rushed the field, John Anderson and I were escorted by a New York City police officer to the Yankee dugout on the first base side. I felt this was my team's time to celebrate, so I did not go onto the field or infringe on their precious moment. Instead, I watched from afar and then entered the Yankee dugout and walked through the underground tunnel behind home plate to the visitors' clubhouse on the third base side and waited for my team. As the jubilant players began streaming off the field, I noticed a figure sitting on a bench opposite the clubhouse entrance. When I got closer, I realized it was Don Larsen, a Yankee legend and one of my childhood heroes, who is still the only player in baseball history to pitch a perfect game in the World Series, which he did in 1956. I had witnessed that game with my father. As a player, Larsen was always generous with his time before and after games, always willing to sign autographs and answer questions from young, inquisitive people like me. It had been more than 5 decades since his historic victory, but he held a special place in my heart for his many kindnesses. As I neared the clubhouse door, he stood up and said, "I wanted to congratulate you and your team on such a wonderful victory," extending his hand in a gentle manner that I will never forget. Larsen, waiting outside our triumphant clubhouse with his message of congratulations from the Yankees, was beyond my comprehension. I briefly shared my memories of him and thanked him profusely. It is sometimes said that life often comes full circle. For me, in that brief moment, the clock had turned back to the beginning. We embraced, and with my emotions almost out of control, I turned and joined the exuberant Marlin celebration. After a raucous, champagne-drenched celebration, I walked through our dugout to the field to pay my respects to the Yankee lore, to what our beloved team had accomplished, and as an homage to my father's inextricable link to my baseball emotions. I took a quiet walk around the bases to savor the moment and drink it all in. Sports Illustrated would later erroneously write that I ran around the bases and slid into home plate in a disrespectful way. Nothing could be further from the truth. At my age, I don't slide very well, and more importantly, I had the utmost respect for everyone involved, including Yankees owner George Steinbrenner, a friend whom I also respected greatly. Sadly, sometimes with the media, there is no recourse or opportunity to counter inaccurate reporting. When I arrived home that night, I vividly remember repeating to myself the words that I had said in the stands as the game ended. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And those happened to be the exact words that I had inscribed inside my World Series ring. I remained lost in a haze of so many emotions until I fell asleep. My road to winning the World Series began early, as a child in New York City, avidly watching Yankee games. 5 decades later, I returned to New York with my own Major League team, once again standing at the starting block of my childhood. If one is fortunate, I like to think that dreams can and do come true. So dream big. You never know. Chapter 2. The Art Came Early. Art and architecture create a dialogue between the generations, developing across time. Vincent Scully. My father taught me to love baseball. My mother taught me to love art. She and I began that journey when I was 5 years old. We would spend part of the day in the lush green meadows and tree-lined paths of Central Park, and then, on the way home, my mother would stop at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. What was billed as a quick detour would turn into a slow walk through the collections and exhibitions. My mother particularly liked to linger by the old master paintings. She was a highly intelligent and dedicated secondary school teacher who taught history and economics at a time when women were not often hired in those fields. But art was her personal passion. She took me not just to museums, but to galleries and auction rooms. The times when my father accompanied us, I remember her doing most of the discussing while my father did all the listening. One day, she returned home with a small Rembrandt etching. She had carefully saved her teacher's salary to purchase the work from an art gallery, and suddenly, the artist whose work she had coveted in the museum now held a place of pride on our living room wall. This moment began my own journey of collecting. I still have the etching as a memory and reminder of the woman who first inspired my eye. It never occurred to me, or to my parents, that I could not love both baseball and beautiful art, and at least once my mother's eye for beautiful objects saved my sports future. The sidewalks outside our home in the Yorkville section of Manhattan on East 86th Street were not large enough for a baseball diamond, but they were perfect for punch ball, a New York street game which is played exactly like the name suggests, a hard rubber ball punched with one's fist instead of a wooden bat. Once, I executed a perfect punch, sending the ball straight into the third-story window of a neighbor. The police were summoned and went directly to my parents' apartment while I sat in the street, nervously awaiting the outcome. Luckily, the police officer also admired antique furniture, and he started discussing antiques with my parents rather than the broken window. When our neighbors moved, no one was happier than my father, who enjoyed watching our punchball games from our third-floor window. but my sister, who was 3 years younger than me and undoubtedly my biggest fan, always rooted for my team. We were a close, tight-knit family of four. At Stuyvesant High School, my love of sports had an opportunity to flower. I was both the sports editor for the school newspaper and editor-in-chief of a sports magazine called Box Seat, which I founded. I also played second base for the school baseball team. I was small for my age, so I had no chance to be a power hitter, but I was a solid infielder. On several occasions, I was more than solid. During my junior year, I made an unassisted triple play. With players on first and second base, the opposing team attempted a double steal. As both runners took off, I caught the batter's sinking line drive, stepped on second base, and instead of throwing to first, I chased down the runner and tagged him out. As one of the fastest players on the team, I was well suited for the chase. At 17, I applied to four colleges: Columbia, Union, Trinity, and Yale. Trinity College was by far my first choice. Each summer, my family rented a house in the village of Lake Shinnerock in upstate New York. My sister and I would remain in the country with my mother, while my father, an attorney, returned to Manhattan during the week. The summer of my junior year, I met a Trinity graduate who was a neighbor in Lake Shinnerock. He sang the praises of his college experience, so much so that by the time my parents and I traveled to Hartford to visit Trinity, I was primed to be very impressed. On the way home, I told my parents I would only consider attending Trinity. They listened, and then suggested we stop briefly in New Haven to see Yale, since it was on our way. I didn't even want to get out of the car, but my mother insisted, and we walked around the old campus. I remained adamantly uninterested. Months later, my college acceptance letters arrived. I was accepted at Columbia, at Union, and at Yale, and rejected at Trinity. This was a blessing in disguise. My Yale education would have a defining influence on the rest of my life. While I was at Yale, my parents encouraged me to concentrate on a pre-medical education so that I could become a physician or even a surgeon. During one of my first days in the zoology laboratory, we were assigned to study the cells of a live palmetto bug. I was instructed to immerse my laboratory specimen in water. Instead, I was the only student in the class whose science experiment literally got away from him. Being a true New Yorker, I instinctively swatted the palmetto bug and killed it with my shoe. About 2 weeks later, I received a bill for $25 from the bursar's office for my dead bug. That's when I decided that my nascent medical career was over. Yale had a required core curriculum, which, as fate would have it, included taking at least one history course. I was not especially interested in general American or European history, but art history sounded more intriguing, and I figured perhaps it would help me understand the works I had seen at the Met with my mother. The general art history course was also well known, even outside Yale, and was taught by leading scholars, including Vincent Scully. I registered, and it was not an exaggeration to say that this course changed my life. By the end of my freshman year, I had decided to major in art history. The conversation with my parents about my choice was met with silence on the other end of the phone. Was their expensive investment in Yale going toward the pursuit of a questionable future career? Later, my mother and father admitted their profound anxiety. What on earth would their son do with that kind of education? As a parent now, I can understand their concern. But I also know the importance of encouraging one's passion. I soon realized the value of having a good personal library for my studies and embarked on what became a lifelong interest in collecting art reference books. A fellow student was unwittingly a great help. Yale picked up bulky refuse on Wednesday mornings. Almost every Tuesday night, my upstairs dormitory neighbor discarded a stack of books on the front steps of our dorm. I'm not sure why he didn't keep his books, but it turned out to be the perfect way for me to start my library. That neighbor was Jack Hines, heir to the famed food products empire, and we became friends. He was a popular United States senator from Pennsylvania when he was tragically killed in a terrible aviation accident in 1991. Jack was only 52 years old. I had many remarkable teachers, but none more so than the legendary Professor Vincent Scully, who made an indelible impression on me, as he did on many others. He was not only a preeminent scholar in art and architectural history, he also possessed a magnetic personality. Being both a brilliant scholar and a showman, when he spoke, you listened. What he taught me, I could not have learned anywhere else. He made art and architecture come to life. I have been fortunate to know many of the world's foremost painters and sculptors. Being in Vincent Scully's company was no different. He was just the first. Vince, as he was universally known, gave me the tools for not only how to see, but also how to analyze and be introspective. How do you measure works against each other and against your own acquired knowledge? Are they good or are they great? It's all about learning to use your eyes. I wondered then, and probably still wonder now, how he was able to see the things he saw. His eyes missed nothing. He also taught me to see in three dimensions, which was vital for relating to both sculpture and architecture. My deep interest in sculptors and sculptures as an art dealer was clearly attributable to my Yale studies. Vince had a particularly humanistic approach to architecture. To him, buildings were living entities, not just brick and mortar or slabs of concrete and steel populating the horizon. I came to realize that we live as we do because of the things that surround us. Quality is essential, whether in painting, sculpture, or architecture. When we take too much for granted, when we stop truly seeing our environment, we become comfortable with the status quo. Vince taught me that you don't have to accept being immobilized by visual pollution. I never forgot that. How I learned to see also mattered no matter what I was looking at. Vince taught me to visualize not only the subject, but its underlying elements, which build the composition in two and three dimensions. If we look beyond whatever surface imagery the artist may be trying to use to attract and keep our attention, we begin to find the underlying elements of structure and composition that combine to empower and give depth of meaning to the surface imagery we notice first. The construction and geometry of all the compositional elements then have to move in a manner that supports what we see in front of us. This is what produces great art. But this process occurs in more than art. In baseball, seeing is crucial to unraveling the subtleties of the game. For both great hitters and pitchers, there exists a formula and a physicality that when they come together can yield an extraordinary player. The players who achieve ultimate success usually possess not only athletic talent, but also an ability to see the flow of the game and make necessary adjustments quickly to take advantage of an opponent's flaws. The most powerful image that I recall Vince teaching me how to see was Leonardo da Vinci's Mona Lisa, perhaps the world's most famous painting. Known for its subject's iconic smile, the painting actually has a complex pattern of imagery, creating multiple layers and subtleties that produce its overlay of mystery. Da Vinci's composition guides our eyes across the entire painting's surface, not just the figure. And when we pause to concentrate, we see that the enigmatic quality of the Mona Lisa's smile might actually be formed less by the corners of her mouth and more by what's rendered in the background. She is surrounded by a landscape, but on closer inspection, it is a highly mysterious place. The imagery is built on allusions to land and water and winding paths, like an elaborately constructed fantasy. The winding paths beside the figure's shoulders rotate up to the waves in her hair before reaching the foggy edge of a waterscape, which pulls our eyes further into the atmospheric ambiguity of the landscape, where perhaps land, or trees, and or water meet along an uncertain, broken displacement of fog and sky. It is that enigmatic, mysterious background imagery which we see that fundamentally shapes our experience of the painting. But we must look for it. Vince taught me that we might think we know what we are seeing, but if we in fact did, how would Mona Lisa's smile in Da Vinci's masterpiece continue to so thoroughly and brilliantly captivate our collective brains for centuries? Many years after my graduation, Vince called to elicit my help. Yale had decided to demolish the Divinity School's handsome library and alter the complex of Neo-Georgian buildings, which many considered a masterpiece of the architect James Gamble Rogers, who had transformed Yale in the first half of the 20th century. Vince passionately implored me to call the university's president, Rick Levin, to voice how important these edifices were to Yale and its history. In the end, the Divinity School, although altered, was saved, thanks in part to Vince's Herculean effort and President Levin's vital foresight. When my daughter Samantha arrived at Yale, I suggested that she take Vince's course, as he was nearing the end of his career. Sure enough, the year after she took his class, he retired, although he returned as a visiting professor and gave occasional public lectures. For decades, his trademark opening was to slam his 10-foot pointer on the dais as a signal for the slide projectionist to begin. The deafening noise also captured the students' attention. Suddenly, the lights would dim, and the magical experience of seeing, hearing, and learning from Vince would commence. Years later, when I audited one of Vince's last classes, I noticed that everything was the same, with one exception. Instead of feverishly scribbling notes, students were now typing in rapid-fire keystrokes on their laptops. Without question, Vince had a profound influence on many generations. The last time I saw Vince was in Miami. I often invited him to come see the Marlins on opening day, and he and his wife Tappy would sit with me. As I began writing this book, I thought repeatedly and warmly about Vince Scully. One of my greatest personal and professional regrets involved the famed 20th century master sculptor and painter Alberto Giacometti. Toward the end of his life, Giacometti invited me to visit him in Paris. It was a rare invitation, but I repeatedly postponed my trip, telling myself I would eventually make the visit. I was too late. He died of heart disease before I got to Paris, and I vowed to never let that happen again. Now, I promised myself that I would call Vince and see him one last time. Exactly 12 hours after I made this promise to myself, Vince died. Glowing obituaries appeared in the New York Times, Washington Post, Associated Press, and other media, yet they scarcely captured the positive impact he had had on generations of art historians, architects, world leaders, historic preservationists, and most importantly, aspiring young minds. My mother instilled great curiosity in me and prompted me to always ask questions. Vince taught me how to fundamentally use my eyes as the tool to discover the answers. Chapter 3. The Path Forward. Being good in business is the most fascinating kind of art. Andy Warhol. I've always been more interested in buying and selling art than in creating it. At Yale, I took one course in drawing and painting at the School of Art. Traditional scholars of art history frown on mixing the two disciplines, believing that the creation of contemporary art does not blend well with the dedicated study of past works. I could appreciate that boundary, but the other truth was, I was not very good at creating original art. I painted four works that I proudly kept in my college room. They were very abstract, probably because I could not draw very well, almost in the style of Jackson Pollock. Shockingly, I managed to trade one with a classmate for a genuine Picasso print. The exchange took several weeks to negotiate. My fellow student was looking for decorative art. I wanted to own the work of an established artist like Picasso. In retrospect, this was hands down the best deal I have ever made, since trading nothing for something is an excellent strategy. The remaining Jeffrey Loria originals were moved from one closet to another, and one of them died a premature death in the trunk of my father's car. Meanwhile, Picasso's works have had quite a different trajectory, and so has my life. In 1960, I met a Yale classmate whose family had just sold their Texas dairy farm business for $40 million. Even by today's standards, that is a big sum, but in the early 1960s, it was enormous. The student introduced himself by saying that he didn't know anything about art, but had a keen interest to learn. Would I help him? The word on campus was that I knew a bit about art history, and he asked me to accompany him to New York City to buy art. The trip exposed me for the first time to the monetary side of art and to the workings of auction houses, a frenzied landscape even back then. My eyes were opened to a world of financial options that I had never thought possible. Art history degrees generally led to an occupation as an art historian, professor, lecturer, or author. I now saw that perhaps I could turn my education into something financially exciting. I decided to apply to business school and to explore the possibility of combining art history with finance. In 1962, I was accepted at the Wharton School of Business at the University of Pennsylvania. I'll never forget my June 1962 Yale graduation weekend. The highlight was a captivating commencement address by President John F. Kennedy. I sat transfixed in the second row while he spoke about the truths and myths of our economy. He called on business and labor to cooperate with the government. It was riveting. No less unforgettable was my conversation with my father following the festivities. Every day, my father read the New York Times, which he folded vertically so he could easily carry it on a crowded New York City subway car. Arriving in New Haven with his paper tucked under his arm, he showed me an article about the plans by Sears Roebuck and Company to expand across the United States, more than doubling its existing footprint of 40 stores. Sears had also just hired Vincent Price, a well-known actor both on the stage and in films. He was especially popular for his chilling roles in horror movies. But he had also won the $64,000 question television game show, with art as his area of expertise. As a result, he enjoyed not only fame as a movie star, but also widespread esteem for his knowledge of art. What excited my father was that Sears was planning on selling original art in its stores across the country. Its strategy was to cultivate a new, more affluent clientele and make the Sears brand more upscale by introducing fine art, as opposed to simply selling the tools and home appliances it was known for. My father saw an opportunity and proposed that I write to Mr. Price, to which I replied, "Dad, I'm going to business school at Wharton. You write to him." Well, unbeknownst to me, that is exactly what he did. My father penned a letter to Vincent and mailed it to Variety magazine, asking if they would please forward it to Mr. Price. In the letter, he mentioned that we were both Yale graduates, as well as my passion for art, and gave him my home phone number. Soon after my graduation in the summer of 1962, I was making arrangements to move to Philadelphia. Early one morning, the telephone rang, and the voice on the other end said, "Hello, this is Vincent Price." To which I replied, "Dad, stop fooling around," and hung up. The telephone rang again, and the same voice said, "No, this is really Vincent Price." He told me he was busy with his Hollywood movie and theater commitments, including performances on the London stage, and he was searching for someone to help him with the Sears project to sell original art. He was glad to see that I lived in New York City, the art capital of the country and probably the world. We spoke for a few minutes and arranged to meet the following week. After I hung up the phone, my mind began to race, imagining the possibilities. A week later, I met Vincent for breakfast in the Berkshire Hotel at Madison Avenue and 52nd Street. Afterward, we explored galleries all day as he sought to assess my eye and taste. We had enjoyed a similar education at Yale and even had some of the same professors, so he viewed me as a somewhat younger version of himself, minus any experience in acting. He was also more irreverent than me. He was well known for owning an amusing collection of fake drawings, which reflected his oddball approach to the authenticity of artworks. At Madison and 82nd Street, we walked into a gallery called The Drawing Shop. I spied a small ink drawing by Léon Lhermitte, a minor 19th century French Barbizon school artist. The work was a double-sided depiction of a peasant seated in a field. I later told Vincent that I went back and bought it, to which he replied with great surprise that he had admired the drawing as well and was considering doing the same. I still own that first purchase. I have never lost my affinity for drawings. They are frequently a unique window into the artist and the artistic process. They are the medium where ideas first enter the world from the mind of the artist. Picasso worked out his ideas on paper. Even for a sculptor, often the initial creation begins in the mind, then finds its way to paper, and only after that to the three-dimensional object. Drawings are also very personal, intimate exercises. They establish a kind of historical record for the artist and their creative process, and many artists are reluctant to part with them. A few days later, Vincent offered me a job as an assistant buyer at Sears. I was essentially Vincent's ghost, buying art in New York and Europe for a project that none of us knew for sure would work. One of my first important meetings was in Jenkintown, Pennsylvania, with Julius Rosenwald, a major Sears shareholder and part owner of the retailer. It was really Vincent's meeting, and I was invited to come along. I didn't want to look like a college student, so I bought a new suit. During our meeting, Rosenwald showed us some of his print collection. Much of it was later gifted to the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. I was a 21-year-old kid trying to absorb the subtleties of the different prints that he was showing to Vincent. To fill our inventory, I began searching for works on paper from young new artists as well as older established ones. Our first gallery was scheduled to open in 1963 for a limited time in Phoenix. It was the forerunner of pop-up galleries. It fell under the domain of home furnishings, although art is not a couch, and the home furnishings people could have cared less. In fact, they didn't like giving up floor space in their department. Although the Vincent Price collection, 17th century to the present, was widely advertised in local newspapers and on radio and television, everyone was nervous, waiting for the response from the public. I still remember when Vincent called to tell me that every picture in the gallery had sold. I was elated. Clearly, our concept could work, and people outside New York City were also eager to buy carefully chosen fine art. After that initial success, the business prospered. I became the youngest full buyer in Sears history, traveling the country, buying art, and helping set up the galleries. Paintings, drawings, watercolors, mixed media, and graphics all had to be purchased, and all the works were expected to be original, many of them unique. The Vincent Price collection did not deal in reproductions. We established 10 to 15 new galleries a month, each open for about 2 to 3 weeks, and moved our inventory around the country without the help of a computer. Sears arranged for a central warehouse in Chicago to store the art and distribute it from there. There were racks and racks of art, organized and categorized with lists and index cards to tell us where each piece was traveling. I would send a Rembrandt etching and Picasso drawing to places like Las Vegas and Arlington, Virginia, and other works to a new venue in Indianapolis. Transporting sculpture was particularly difficult, but we did occasionally have sculptures in our temporary galleries. During this time, I even initiated the first mail-order catalog for art. After all, Sears was the largest mail-order company in the country, and it naturally followed that art could be sold that way as well. The catalog achieved enormous success, selling graphics by Salvador Dali, Henry Moore, Pablo Picasso, and others. But I couldn't be an art buyer in New York and attend graduate school at Wharton. I visited the admissions office at Columbia University School of Business, explained my situation, and asked if they would allow me to transfer from Wharton. Columbia said yes. What should have been a 2-year Master of Business Administration degree took me 6 years to complete because my job involved so much travel and consumed such an enormous amount of time. But I knew that I had made the right decision. I was also fortunate to make a treasured lifelong friend. Max Davidson was an assistant buyer at Sears for piece goods while I purchased art for the Vincent Price collection. Eventually, Max joined the Sears art program. Today, Max is an important gallery owner and dealer, specializing in kinetic art, with a stable of established and promising American and international painters and sculptors, such as George Rickey, Tom Wesselman, and Pedro de Movellon. Our friendship has lasted almost 60 years. We still speak several times a week, often reminiscing about our bygone days at Sears. One of the champions of the Sears art program was an executive vice president named George Struthers, who was a visionary corporate leader. He knew that selling fine art at Sears was controversial, but it brought a new clientele of professional people such as doctors, lawyers, and school teachers into the stores to see the art. Sears blazed a trail that other department store chains, like E.J. Corvette and Alexander's in New York, soon copied. Struthers also introduced me to his friend Harry Sundheim, a former toy buyer and a Chicago art collector. Sundheim, in turn, introduced me to the artist René Magritte in 1963. I still remember the first time I visited Magritte in Brussels. His kitchen table had 6 or 7 beautiful gouaches in progress, and his ever-present bowler hat was sitting nearby. In retrospect, I wish I had purchased some of those gouaches lying on his kitchen table. On a typical weekday afternoon, I would purchase prints by Picasso, Matisse, Rembrandt, and other major artists. I would travel to Chads Ford, Pennsylvania, to acquire watercolors from the esteemed American artist Andrew Wyeth, and arrange commissions with other internationally known artists, including Man Ray. On behalf of Sears, I asked him to produce a multicolored lithograph of a still-life basket of fruit and often visited with him in Paris, both during the process and afterward. And that is how I came to meet Salvador Dali. In many ways, Sears was the perfect venue for Salvador Dali, who was both a genius and a showman. Having studied surrealism at Yale, I understood his role as a dominant force in the movement. In the 1920s and 1930s, the surrealists embraced a philosophy largely influenced by the writings of psychologist Sigmund Freud. Their primary focus was on ideas and imagery born out of the dream state or subconscious mind. As a result, the Surrealists rejected societal rules and institutions, such as the church and government, considering them to be restrictive and burdensome. One of Dali's best-known paintings, and one of Surrealism's most iconic images, The Persistence of Memory, 1931, epitomizes this notion with its images of melting clocks in a Spanish village landscape. The painting quite literally bends any traditional understanding of time. ants appear strangely attracted to the metal casing of a pocket watch, while a distorted, fleshy, semi-self-portrait laid bare in the center of the landscape attracts a melted timepiece. For Dolly, who was raised by a Roman Catholic mother and an atheist father in the Catalan region of Spain, the idea of contradicting traditional imagery may have been implanted early. He tended to side with his father's views and was drawn to science at an early age. With all of his pronounced eccentricities, one might imagine Dolly as having an affinity for the abstract, but his interests were constructed around allegory and storytelling. Some of his most fantastical paintings from the early 1950s were clearly influenced by great masterpieces in history, particularly the Renaissance, often in combination with science and mathematical reasoning. I was particularly struck by his works like The Sacrament of the Last Supper, 1955, at the National Gallery of Art, and Crucifixion, 1954, at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. But while his brilliant compositions and technical mastery were profoundly eye-popping and mind-bending, Dolly was equally at home creating controversy in real life. During the winters, he lived at the St. Regis Hotel in New York City. He spent the balance of his time in the small fishing village of Port Lligat in Spain, near the Costa Brava town of Cadiz. Most afternoons, when he was in New York, Dolly could be found at the St. Regis's King Cole Bar, holding court at a conspicuously prominent table. His desire for publicity and controversy were insatiable, and a perfect match for my first big proposal: to have Dolly create an original painting and 300 accompanying numbered and signed colored lithographs for Sears. When he produced the Mystical Rose Madonna painting and the 300 prints for Sears in 1963, his vision of the impact of science on religion was a wonder to behold. The body of the Madonna was his vehicle for the depiction of the rose in the center of the figure. Painted as a startling focal point, there is a partial image of a doorway that seems to refer to the negative space of a cube. It frames the floating red rose at the heart of the Madonna's life force, as in his Crucifixion. Sears, at my urging, spent $25,000 on the project, which was a large sum at the time for a commission, but the project netted the company $120,000 for the prints alone. Sears retained the original painting, but later sold it. Today, it is part of the Maria Jose Jove Foundation Art Collection in A Coruña, Spain. Dolly and I became friends, and over the years we saw each other often, both in New York and in Port Lligat. For me, it was a vibrant, life-affirming friendship. Imaginative ideas poured from his fertile mind at such an accelerated rate that the less imaginative among us, and that was just about everyone, really needed to pay careful attention in order to process what he had to say. But it was all worth processing. He had much to share. One year, at the St. Regis, Dolly decided that it was imperative for him to acquire a pet ocelot. Now, for those of us more accustomed to the company of a domesticated cat, let me put this in perspective. Think of a wild bobcat roaming around an elegant suite at the St. Regis. Then add a few feline pounds. Dolly named the creature Babu. It was beautiful to look at, and fortunately, not quite big enough to tear off a limb. An ocelot, however, is inherently a carnivorous beast, naturally accustomed to sleeping most of the day and roaming at night in search of prey. Babu's nocturnal travels, other than those on a leash with Dolly, were restricted to the suite's bathroom. He spent a great deal of his time living in the bathtub, where he continually marked his territory, which begs the question, where did Dolly shower? Dolly's wife, Gala, who genuinely appreciated the virtues of a clean bathtub, kept her own suite across the hall. But no separation was great enough to curb the intense scent of Babu's urine, which permeated the hallway of the St. Regis and was immediately noticeable the moment one exited the elevator onto Dolly's floor. The odor would hit you like a wild fastball. Dolly's need for this animal in his room was part of his powerful imagination and sometimes absurd obsessions. It wasn't much different from his compulsive need to acquire an elephant skull collection that he warehoused in what he named the throne room in his Port Liggett home. Gala often told me that left to his own devices without her steadying hand, Dolly, as she called him, would have lived in a house of madness, horrors, and the outrageous. The reality was shocking enough that it can be hard to imagine what those might have been. Meeting Dolly was one of those milestone moments that in retrospect anticipated the very fortunate and unique course my life would take. He was the first painter that I reached out to in my professional career, and perhaps meeting such a liberated mind so early afforded me the opportunity to believe that anything was possible. When I started buying art, I was working for Vincent, but soon I was hired by Sears. One of the company's internal journals placed me on its cover with the title Bird Dog on Madison Avenue. But in spite of the art program's success, a new team in the executive offices was not convinced that the public would want Sears-sold art in the future. I saw the handwriting on the wall. In 1965, I established Jeffrey H. Loria and Company, Incorporated, and became a private art dealer. My father backed my efforts with a $2,000 loan. That seed money was all I needed. I am glad that the eventual result justified my father's early faith in me. Vincent and I maintained a close friendship until he died in 1993. When I wrote a book titled Collecting Original Art in 1965, Vincent was kind enough to write the foreword. At the time, there were no books about collecting fine art. This book answered many of the questions that both new and experienced collectors had asked me during my travels for Sears. Now, I hoped that it would serve me well as I struck out on my own. My father, who was an inventor as well as an attorney, had convinced me that an invention is finding a need and then filling it. And that's what I sought to do with my first book and in my approach to business. In his foreword, Vincent said that I was not only art-excited, but people-excited. He was right. That principle would extend to baseball as well, where I often conversed with the players in the clubhouse as well as the fans in the stadium. My passions for art and baseball are really about getting to know the participants and for the engaging conversations that prompt passionate discussions. I've been privileged to experience both of them over a lifetime. 2 years after writing Collecting Original Art, I published another book, What's It All About, Charlie Brown? The comics of Charles Schulz and his Peanuts creations had always fascinated me. He shone a spotlight on a host of fields such as sports, religion, politics, education, and psychology. So after meeting with Schulz several times, I wrote a tongue-in-cheek book about the cartoonist's valuable insights as seen through the prism of the Peanuts characters. When Schulz wrote me a personal note, he mentioned that his favorite American artist was Andrew Wyeth, whom I had visited in Chad's Ford and in Maine and knew well. Schulz sent me a drawing to give to Andrew, and they became friends. It was gratifying for me to introduce the iconic American cartoonist to the revered American artist. From time to time, people ask me, "What does an art dealer do?" Once in a while, I will half-jokingly say, "I am a professional hunter." But actually, that is not too far from the truth. Art dealers are often on the hunt for the best works of the highest quality, searching for the finest examples from an artist's total body of work. One needs to develop keen eyes to spot the great work, and one needs to be able to move quickly. Mobility has always been an integral part of my career. I greatly enjoyed meeting celebrated art dealers and artists. I learned much from, for example, Sam Saltz, who dealt in 19th and 20th century masterpieces, and from the late Harold Diamond, another private dealer specializing in important 20th century art. I admired their flexibility, untethered to any physical location, such as a commercial gallery. I recall seeing Saltz by chance once in the lobby of the Hotel Plaza Athénée in Paris. He was carrying a parcel as we both entered the elevator. The flat, square-wrapped parcel immediately piqued my interest. By the time we exited on the fifth floor, I had purchased the Picasso drawing that he carried. It was never my desire to be a merchant with a retail presence. For me, it was critical to spend more time getting to know great artists and collectors. If I had operated a gallery, I could not have been as creative and mobile. It is true that you could miss meeting a great collector or artist by not possessing a public space, but one of the benefits of my life has been that the world became my gallery. There's something about the hunting metaphor that might sound heartless and disconnected from emotional attachments produced by great art. But it isn't uncommon for a dealer to search for something that they either know a client might want or believe a client might be attracted to. So part of that hunt is for a special work that I, as a dealer, know or suspect a client might eventually connect with emotionally. Of course, emotion is only one of many reasons why a particular work is desirable for a collector. But regardless of a collector's motivation, art always seems to possess an affinity for evolved taste, which exists beyond the immediate needs for sustenance. Humans,
since they began. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.